Good morning, viewers. We have come once again in our series of legal literacy. And this morning we shall be discussing the implication of judgments given in a case handled by lawyers and Max. And that judgment was given recently. We're going to discuss the implication of that or judgment vis-a-vis the HIV/AIDS Anti-Discrimination Act 2014. Now, it is a case involving an individual I would like to refer to as Mr. X here. And we have used that simply to conceal the identity of the parties involved. But what is important to us this morning that just that feels everyone must know about is the implication of that judgment and all the issues that we have around the HIV/AIDS Anti-Discrimination Act 2014. That is the name of the federal legislation that we have on HIV/AIDS. There is the domestication of that act, of that act and similar laws in many of the states of the federation. Now, the case in question, the case of Mr. X, was actually instituted in the year 2016, sometime in 2016, and about a year after, and specifically in around the September 2017, the court actually ordered that parties should file a complaint in that case, because the matter had commenced in 2016 by what we call originating or summons. And so the court ordered the filing of a complaint so that parties can actually take oral evidence and listen to oral evidence from parties. And so specifically on the 8th of September 2017, the claimant in that case, that is lawyer Salat, who is acting on behalf of the claimant, that is Mr. X, or put in or its complaint and other relevant processes on the 8th of September 2017. Thereafter, the defendants, we have four defendants in that case representing organizations involved and some of the officers. And so they were also all were represented by a lawyer. So they filed their defense and served on the claimant subsequently, and the case began in earnest. It went into hearing, and after about a year, a judgment was entered in that case. And specifically on the 26th of September this year, that is about a month ago, judgment was entered by the National Industrial Court, sitting in Abuja. And so, what we simply want to do this morning is to look at the issues raised and the issues resolved in that judgment and the implication of those issues as resolved by the court or in relation to the HIV/AIDS Anti-Discrimination Act 2014. Because that act is on the basis of that act that lawyers and act actually approached the court on behalf of the claimant in that case. And so that judgment has a lot of implications for the provisions of the act. In fact, that judgment actually enabled us to have interpretations to certain provisions of that law, of that act. And so we are going to really look at them one after the other. And let's remember, the act became operational on the 27th day of November 2014. That was the commencement date of that act. And so, for an employment to actually or come under the provision, under the application of that act, it then means the employment must have continued beyond the 27th of November 2014. And so, So it does not apply to any employment that commenced before and ended before, that commenced and ended before the 27th day of November. But then, if there is an employment or any or such relationship that began before the 27th day of November, but continued after that date, that employment will also come under the application of the Act. So when it commences does not matter, but what is important is that does the employment continues beyond the 27th day of November 2014? If the answer is yes, it then means that relationship comes under the application of the HIV AIDS Anti-Discrimination Act 2014. Now, to start with, now, an employee is given a very wide definition under the Act, that is the HIV AIDS Anti-Discrimination Act 2014. And there, in fact, we cannot really exhaust the width and the length of that Act in respect of the definition that's given to an employee. But it's only important to tell you that the only relationship that has the color of employment or that has the color of engagement that does not come under the application of that Act is that which relates to an independent contractor. And so the Act excludes any relationship that has to do with independent contracting. That is, that relates to an independent contractor, the agent of an independent contractor, or the representative of an independent contractor are the only things taken out of the definition of an employee on that act. Any other relationship that has a color of engagement or employment that you can envisage, that anyone can envisage, actually fall within the purview of the HIV AIDS Anti-Discrimination Act 2014. And another thing again that was there in mind is that it does not just apply to an employee. The Act also envisages even an applicant. And that is to say that not until an individual becomes an employee before it can take the advantage of that Act, one who is an applicant can also take advantage. So there can be discrimination based on HIV status of even an applicant or somebody that has not even become an employee. So which means all pre-employment processes also come within the application of the Act. Let's bear in mind. And that was part of the judgment in that case. In fact, the court specifically highlighted these issues in that judgment, and it made copious references to provisions of the HIV Anti-Discrimination Act and all other relevant laws, the Constitution and the African Charter on Human and People's Rights, and a lot of other laws, even to international best practices and even to protocols and other things to which Nigeria is a signatory. So let's bear that very important. And so basically three things I highlighted in that judgment. The first that we're going to discuss is compulsory testing, HIV testing. Even though the judgment or acknowledge the provision of the Labor Act, where it says an employer can go ahead to request for a medical fitness certificate or testing for itself, for an employee or a prospective employee, it goes ahead to say that it will be wrong by the provision of the Act and all relevant laws to order a compulsory HIV testing. That is, HIV testing, no employer can make HIV testing as part of what they normally call medical fitness testing for an employee or a prospective employee. That is, was and is establishing that judgment. And it is important for us to actually take very good notice of that. Because it is a commonplace these days where employers or prospective employers goes ahead to order compulsory HIV testing for both for either employees or prospective employees and or those that will refer to as applicants, even in the process of undergoing pre-employment processes. So it is wrong by the provision of that act, and that was highlighted in that judgment in Mr. X's case. Very, very important. Compulsory HIV testing, acknowledged by that judgment as wrong and unlawful, as illegal. And so it is illegal on the part of any employer to do what? To order anyone to undergo compulsory HIV testing. If there must be an HIV testing, then it must be done with the consent of either the applicant or the prospective employee or the substantive employee. So the consent, the informed consent, so to say, the informed consent of the applicant or the prospective employee or the employee must be sought and had before any employer can go ahead to conduct any compulsory HIV testing on the employee. And so nobody is saying you cannot conduct other tests to determine the medical fitness of a prospective employee or an employee. We are not saying it is illegal to do so, no. But what we are saying is that it is unlawful to order a compulsory HIV testing. That should be clear. And that is the first we're going to talk about as an implication of that judgment in Mr. S's case. Now, the other one is discrimination on the basis of real or perceived HIV status. That is very, very important. And in fact, basically, that was the fulcrum. That was the basis of that suit with the lawyers that Lawyers and Art instituted on behalf of Mr. X. Mr. X was employed as a guard in a particular organization. I will not mention that organization as it is, but in a particular organization, and in the process, they were ordered to undergo some medical tests. And they pretended that was to determine their medical fitness for the job they were employed to do. Eventually, it was discovered that Mr. S tested positive to HIV. And what happened? The employer, as a result of that, went ahead to terminate the employment of Mr. X. And that was why Lawyers and Art approached the court on behalf of Mr. X. And so, basically, the court, after about 1 or 1.5 years of legal battle in court, that judgment was given. And so, the court highlighted copiously in that judgment that it will amount to discrimination for you to terminate or dismiss the employment, to terminate the employment of an individual, or dismiss an individual on the basis of he being infected with HIV, or on the basis of his HIV status. In fact, the question will even be that, how do we come to even determine that, to discover that, if it was even illegal in the first place to order a compulsory HIV testing? In fact, they were, in that case, they were not even told they were undergoing any HIV test. They only told them they had appointed a particular medical facility where each of the employee was supposed to go and undergo some testings. So they never knew what they were being tested for. All they knew was that they took samples of their blood and some other necessary things, and they underwent some testing. Eventually, when the result came out, the employee then discovered that HIV testing was part of what they had been made to undergo. And so on that basis, his employment was terminated. So that termination in itself is what we're talking about now. It will amount to discrimination. In fact, the court went ahead to even hold that supposing the HIV/AIDS Anti-Discrimination Act 2014 had not even come into operation at all. In fact, that Mr. X could have taken cover under Section 42 of the Constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, which talks about discrimination on some basis, generally, as stated in that section of the Constitution. Even though HIV was not specifically stated in that section of the Constitution as one of the reasons upon which discrimination, illegal discrimination, or discrimination can arise, it says that that section of the Constitution do not also foreclose the possibility of other possible areas of discrimination. In fact, the court went to cite the instance of maybe a discrimination on the basis of an individual being an albino, even though that section 42 of the Constitution did not make provision for that, did not envisage that kind of situation, but that the court will never close its eyes to the possibility of discrimination on the basis of other things apart from those envisaged in that section 42 of the Constitution. And so it will be wrongful of an employer, it will be unlawful of any employer to terminate or dismiss an employee, or not to even employ an individual on the basis that he or she is HIV positive or has tested positive to the HIV, Very, very important. And another important thing that we must bear in mind is that this is the issue of confidentiality. Now, the court in that judgment also made scanty references to the issue of confidentiality of the status of an individual. And so what the Act says is that even where an employee or a prospective employee has consented to an HIV testing, and the testing is positive, or has shown that the individual is positive, is HIV positive, then the employer is duty bound to respect the confidentiality of that employee or prospective employee. And what that means is that employer is duty bound not to disclose such information of the HIV status of the employee or prospective employee to a third party. And this goes ahead to for one, medical institutions who from time to time are engaged by employers to conduct medical tests on employees and prospective employees. And such medical facilities go ahead to disclose the results of the HIV status of such employees to or the employer. It would be unlawful of such medical facilities to do so, because in that case, the employer becomes a third party. And so confidentiality should be maintained. No disclosure, even where one has information as to the HIV status of an individual to a third party. In fact, there is a court that is still pending in court, a case that is still pending in court, which has been instituted by lawyers alert. That case is has been tagged and as by leave of court is proceeding under the name Miss A. And we hope the judgment in that court also favors Miss A. In fact, in that case, it's even a case where the defendant is a federal medical center. In fact, writing at the back of the file of an employee, the status of that employee, and that file was kept in a place that was accessible to all employees. This in itself is illegal because it contravenes the confidentiality provision of the HIV AIDS Anti-Discrimination Act. Because that file is kept open, is kept in a place that is ordinarily accessible to all other employees. And so that will mean that the information about the status of that individual is being communicated to a third party. This is important. And honestly, that judgment has gone in favor of Mr. X. And the court has awarded salaries that were supposed to go to Mr. X for a period of 5 years has been awarded to Mr. X. And some damages has also been awarded. Indeed, Mr. X is going to actually recover a little of what he has lost and the injury he has suffered over the years. And so these are the little implications of that judgment that lawyers that feels the public must know about. You, our viewers, must know about that all employers must be aware of so as to forestall the occurrence of such in future. So as to forestall the future occurrence of issues like this. Thank you very much. There are so many other implications, but these are the little we intend to point out today. We are asking you, put out your questions. If there are questions and anything we want to know generally about the Act itself and all its provisions, if there are things we are aware of going on or in any institution, let us begin, and we are not very sure of the position of the law about such issues, let us begin to put forward our questions. It is when we ask these questions that we will be led as to where to actually touchlight, where to actually look at. And so we count on you. On you, send in your questions. These questions will be attended to. Thank you very much today. Until we come your way again next week, we'll say bye-bye.